Good evening. I'm Amy Ng, curator here at the Frick Collection, and it is my great pleasure to welcome you to the Frick and for our viewers around the world to our live webcast. And just a reminder that nearly all of our lectures are live streamed, recorded, and available for you to watch on our website, frick.org. Last month, we opened the exhibition on view in our lower-level galleries, Bertoldo di Giovanni, The Renaissance of Sculpture in Medici Florence. And the exhibition will remain open for 30 minutes after the lecture, so please feel free to go downstairs after that. I'll just ask you to take a moment now to ensure that your phones will not ring or buzz during the lecture. This is the second in a series of lectures given in conjunction with the Bertoldo exhibition. Alexander Nowell, co-curator of this exhibition with me and with Chief Curator Xavier Salomon, gave an inaugural lecture some weeks ago that you can watch on the website, and mark your calendars, Patricia Lee Rubin will be speaking on Wednesday, December 18th. The Frick's exhibition happens to take place at the same time as another important show on a 15th century Italian Renaissance sculptor. That is the exhibition Verrocchio, Sculptor and Painter of Renaissance Florence at the National Gallery of Art in Washington, D.C. It's a remarkable moment on the East Coast of the United States to have two landmark exhibitions just a train ride away, New York and DC, on almost exactly contemporary sculptors in Renaissance Florence, Bertoldo and Verrocchio, very different artists, but both of whom worked for the Medici family and especially for Lorenzo il Magnifico, the Magnificent, one of the greatest art patrons of Renaissance Italy. We are honored to have with us tonight a Magnifico from the West Coast. Dr. Davide Gasparotto is Senior Curator and Head of the Paintings Department, as well as Chair of Curatorial Affairs at the J. Paul Getty Museum in Los Angeles, California. We are so grateful to have you here, Davide, as a representative of the Getty, and I want to take a moment to acknowledge that we are thinking of our colleagues and everyone affected by the fires in LA. We are at least heartened to know that the art is safe, thanks to the extraordinary bastion that is the Getty Center. Before joining the Getty, Dr. Gasparotto was curator at the Galleria Nazionale di Parma, and in 2012-14, he was director of the Galleria Estense in Modena. Davide's publications, exhibitions, and acquisitions are far too lengthy for me to detail, so I will indulge in only a few highlights. He organized with Guido Beltramini and Adolfo Tura the exhibition Pietro Bembo e l'Invenzione del Rinascimento in Padua, 2013. The remarkable exhibition, again with Guido Beltramini, Aldo Manuzio, Il Rinascimento di Venezia, that was at the Accademia in Venice in 2016. And in the last couple of years, two acclaimed exhibitions at the Getty, Giovanni Bellini, Landscapes of Faith in Renaissance Venice, that was 2017-18, and Pontormo, Miraculous Encounters with Bruce Adelstein, which some of you may have seen here in New York at the Morgan Library and Museum. All of Dr. Gasparotto's exhibitions are, of course, accompanied by catalogs that have significantly advanced the understanding of each of these topics. Under Davide's tenure, the Getty's collection has been profoundly enriched by paintings by Parmigianino, Orazio Gentileschi, Watteau, and most recently Bronzino, and that is just the tip of the iceberg. He is a scholar of deep and broad erudition and a connoisseur with a sharp, sensitive eye. From Giovanni Bellini to Gian Bologna and much more, his expertise reaches far beyond the realm of paintings. A Renaissance man himself, Davide is also an expert in sculpture, including portrait medals, and we have a soft spot for medals here at the Frick. We are eager to hear him speak tonight on Bertoldo and the revival of the antique. Please join me in welcoming Davide Gasparotto to the podium.
Thank you very much, Amy, for this generous presentation and also for the kind invitation to speak here at the Frick tonight. a venerable institution, which I always loved, one of my favorite places in New York. Last, I would say, but not least, because it preserves one of my favorite paintings, Bellini's Magnificent St. Francis in the Desert, which obviously could not travel to my exhibition at the Getty. But I think in some way, the exhibition at the Getty sort of would have complemented in a wonderful way this masterpiece by Bellini. I'm really happy to see that the Frick continues a well-established tradition of focused exhibitions devoted to Renaissance sculpture and bronzes, which were, I think, one of the prides of its holdings. And after the exhibition on the private collections of Claudia Quentin and Tom Hill, and then the monographic shows on Riccio and Antico, it is now the time of Bertoldo Di Giovanni. And I saw briefly in the distance in the room Denise Allen, who was sort of the heart of some of these exhibitions when she was here as a curator. I want to congratulate very, very warmly the curators of this really exhilarating exhibition on Bertoldo. I spent 3 hours here in the this afternoon, Alexander Noel, Amy Eng, and Xavier Salomon. This is not only a truly beautiful installation, but it also provides an extraordinary scholarly and research opportunity. It's a real milestone, and I think also a new starting point for Bertoldo scholarship. I'm very much looking forward to the study day on December 9th. I'm also grateful to Persephone Allen here at the Frick for efficiently assisting me with all the practicalities of the organization of this talk. What I'm going to do tonight is very simple. I will provide, my aim was to provide a wider context for Bertoldo's oeuvre as a maker of, especially of small bronzes and reliefs in bronze, and then talk a little bit about some of the masterpieces in the exhibition. And I would like to start with a question. Is it possible to establish a precise date for the birth of an art form? And I'm here referring to the bronzetto, the small bronze statuette, which is generally considered one of the new art forms invented in the Renaissance, and the protagonist of the spectacular exhibition devoted to Bertoldo Di Giovanni here at the Frick. What do we mean when we speak of the bronze statuette? We mean a figure of reduced size, 7 to 20 inches in height, about 7 to 20 inches in height, cast in bronze using the lost wax technique, with a sacred or more often secular subject, and designed to be an independent object made for the sake of pleasure and for a domestic setting that could be handled and admired from up close. Here you see one of the statuettes in the exhibition, Bertoldo's Hercules on horseback from the Galleria Estense in Modena. We will come back to this later. Technically, we should not speak of invention, but instead of reinvention, since a comparable art form already existed in classical antiquity. Despite the majority of classical small bronzes had a religious or votive purpose, we are well aware that ancient Roman collectors particularly appreciated superbly crafted bronze statuettes, like Novius Vindex, an obscure Roman of the early imperial period who clearly fits into the pattern of Romans who used Greek art to enhance their position and status. Novius Vindex is celebrated by Roman poets Statius and Martial as a collector of Greek sculpture and as the owner of the Hercules Epitrapezios, a bronze statuette by Lysippus showing the Greek hero sitting on a rock on top of which he had stretched out a lion's skin, his club in his left hand and cup in his right. The two Roman poets celebrated the majesty, the dignity, the precision of touch, and the powerful form of the work despite its small size. They also detail the illustrious history of the object's past ownership, which increased its value in the eyes of its owner, since it had, and I quote, watched over the banquets of Alexander the Great, aroused the admiration of Hannibal, and adorned the feasts of Sulla. before entering Novius Vindesig's possession. The name of one of the most famous Greek sculptures, Lysippus, the exquisite craftsmanship and the illustrious provenance contributed to the very special aura which surrounded the object, and by the way, are very similar to the marketing strategies of today's antiquities dealers. Big name, great quality, great provenance. An ancient small bronze of high quality, like the Hercules here on the screen, itself a reduction of the famous Farnese type, the colossal marble sculpture which is in Naples from the Farnese collection, helps us to visualize the type of statuette evoked so suggestively by the two Roman poets. Small bronzes of this kind would certainly have played an important role in the modern rebirth of the genre. The equestrian statuette of the equestrian figure of Marcus Aurelius by Antonio Averlino, known as Filarete, Florentine sculptor and also architect who was trained in the studio of Lorenzo Ghiberti, is often referred as the first small Renaissance bronze. The statuette is a reduction of, and an adaptation of one of the great bronzes survived from antiquity, the colossal equestrian figure of Emperor Marcus Aurelius, which at the time stood in front of the Basilica of St. John in Lateran and is today in the center of the Piazza del Campidoglio, actually replaced by a copy that originally is inside the Museo dei Conservatori in Rome today. Some variations have been introduced into the pose, an elaborate helmet with a group of Nessus and Deianira in relief has been added under the forelegs of the horse. The harness is enriched with gilding and by the use of the Champlevin enameling, which is a peculiar feature of Filarete's bronze doors at St. Peter's. But the statuette itself tells us another interesting story. An inscription on the base, probably added in two different moments, records that this bronze was given by Filarete to Piero de' Medici, father of Lorenzo il Magnifico, in 1465, but also suggests that it was cast in Rome when Filarete was engaged on his pair of bronze doors for St. Peter's Basilica, that is, between 1433 and 1445. The inscription indicates also that Filarete believed that the statuette was a portrait of Emperor Commodus, the infamous son of Marcus Aurelius. We know that during the Middle Ages, the antique group, attracted a wide variety of names, even if by far the most important of these was that of Constantine, the first Christian emperor, which probably allowed the statue to survive intact after the downfall of paganism. The humanist Bartolomeo Platina, who became librarian to Pope Sixtus IV, we are in the like 70s, early 80s in the 400, is credited with having been the first to suggest the identification with Marcus Aurelius, but it was not until about 1600 that this became universally accepted. The year before, in 1464, Filarete dedicated to Piero de' Medici a copy of his treatise on architecture. The precious manuscript is still in the National Library in Florence, where he eloquently portrayed Piero's passion for all small objects of refined craftsmanship in a beautiful passage which is worth to quote in full. And I quote from Filarete. Then on another day, he, cioè Piero, runs over all these volumes with his eye for his pleasure, to pass the time and to give recreation to his sight. Then the next day, he tells me that he has effigies and portraits of all the emperors and noblemen who have ever lived, made in gold, silver, bronze, jewels, marble, or other materials. They are marvelous things to see. Their dignity is such that only looking at these portraits wrought in bronze, excluding those in gold, silver, and in other noble stones, fills his soul with delight and pleasure in their excellence. These give pleasure in two ways to anyone who understands and enjoys them as he does. First, for the excellence of the image represented. Secondly, for the noble mastery of those ancient angelic spirits who with their sublime intellects have made such vile things as bronze, marble, and such materials acquire such great price. Valuable things such as gold and silver have become even greater through their mastery. End of quotation. The quality of the materials and manufacture, lo degno magistero di quegli antichi angelici spiriti, combined with the pleasure of recognizing famous figures from ancient history, la eccellenza della rappresentata immagine, are the main reasons for the delight, voluttà and piacere that Piero derives from contemplating these objects. And it would have been in the same spirit that Piero accepted the gift of the bronze statuette from Filarete, and in the same spirit he would have certainly admired some medals cast by Filarete himself, which are among the first Italian Renaissance medals with the portrait of an ancient Roman emperor. In this case, the infamous Nero, with the scene of the famous suicide of the philosopher Seneca on the reverse. The birth of the bronze statuette is closely related to two major phenomena which are happening in the early 400 between Florence and Rome. One is the revival of bronze casting techniques and the recognition of bronze as the most noble material for sculpture. The other is the increasing appreciation of the antique, fostered by the humanist movement. Arguably, the most complex of sculptural techniques, bronze casting involves a range of materials and diverse skills, and both small and especially large-scale works were generally achieved through collaboration between the sculptor who designed the work and created the model, the founder who cast it, and a host of other artisans and specialists. During the Renaissance, bronze sculptures were generally creating using the ancient lost wax method, in which a wax model is translated into the finished work of art. And here you can see a sort of a short synthesis of the casting procedure, the creation of the model, sometimes with an interior armature in sort of soft material like clay, the work with the wax, so the precise working of the really the shape of the figures, then the creation of a funnel shaped pouring cup and gating system, made of cylindrical wax channels and applied to the model to facilitate the movement of the molten metal into the mold while at the same time allowing the gases to exit. Then the creation of, with layers of clay, the creation of the so-called investment on top of the wax model. Then baking, the form is heated to bake the clay and at the same time to melt out the wax. And from this, the name of lost wax process, because the wax is, you know, pouring out. And then the metal is poured into the mold. Then, once solidified, the investment is removed, and then the sculptor removes all the channels, the pouring cup, and works the finishing with chisels, hammers, punches, and so work on the finishing, and then patination. So this is sort of, in very brief, the method we are talking about when you see these statuettes. They were mostly created in this way. So the lost wax casting, so-called because, as you have seen, the wax model is melted out and thereby lost in the process of creating the bronze, is generally divided in two basic techniques. In the direct method, which is this one which you see on the screen, a model of solid wax or a wax model over a clay core is cast, resulting in the loss of the original model. So there is the creation of one unique object. With the indirect method, a duplicate model is created in wax by taking molds from the original, offering possibility for both model and molds to be retained for future use. This was developed a little bit later in the 400, in the 15th century. It is generally accepted that during the medieval period and in the early Renaissance, so our period, the direct casting method was used. The most fitting example of the revival that bronze sculpture enjoyed in the early Renaissance is the famous competition held in Florence in 1401 by the Arte di Calimala, the guild of foreign wool merchants, for a pair of bronze doors for the baptistry. The competition was entered by seven sculptors, each of whom produced a bronze relief on the subject of the sacrifice of Isaac. Only the reliefs realized by the two finalists, Lorenzo Ghiberti and Filippo Brunelleschi, survived till today. And we know that the commission was awarded to Ghiberti, at the time 20 years old and not yet matriculated. Apparently on the basis of the technical economy of his relief, in comparison to the one by Brunelleschi. The use of less piecing in of separately cast elements, and therefore of less metal, was the crucial factor for Ghiberti's victory. You have to imagine that Brunelleschi's relief is 7 kilos heavier than Ghiberti's. So, you know, an enormous economy in terms of the material, which obviously was very expensive. In the mid-16th century, Vasari, Giorgio Vasari, in his Lives, celebrated the skill of the sculptor of his own time, saying that they were able to produce casts sottili come una costola di coltello, thin as the blade of a knife. And we generally tend to project this image over the Renaissance in general. But over the course of the 15th century, casts came out from the foundry in pretty rough shape, and often the small statuettes were solid cast instead of hollow. The doors took Ghiberti a quarter of a century to execute, and not only for the complexity of the casting process, but for the enormous amount of chasing and cold work which was necessary to take the reliefs to the desired level of finish. Within a year of the completion of the first set of doors, the order was placed for a second pair, which will become the famous Gates of Paradise, which occupied Ghiberti until 1452. So both the doors took basically Ghiberti's entire career to make. These two commissions were of immense importance for the future development of Italian sculpture, as you know. The large new foundry, which Ghiberti set up opposite the Hospital of Santa Maria Nuova for the casting of the doors, was to be the training ground for a new generation of Florentine sculptors who became versed in the skills and fascinated by the possibilities of a sculptural technique, which revived one of the principal media of antiquity. But looking at the relief by Brunelleschi, we notice that none of the figures attains the degree of isolation than the little attendant here in the pose of the ancient spinario, the thorn puller, who occupies the bottom left-hand corner of the formella by Brunelleschi. It is in fact this figure, adapted from a famous classical source, which was obviously visible at the time in the capital in Rome, completely uninvolved in the drama in progress behind it, and actually modeled and cast separately and soldered to the background. It is this figure which stands as the source of the way of thought, which ultimately produced the independent classicizing statuette. The spinario is a good case in point to introduce the other major factor which lie behind the creation of the bronze statuette, the interest and passion for classical antiquity. A series of written sources has handed down the enthusiasm for antique sculpture expressed by some of the leading artists in early Renaissance Florence. Here we only need mention The Journey to Rome by Donatello and Brunelleschi, where they were nicknamed quelli del tesoro, those of the treasure, because they were looking for antiquities. Described by the Florentine architect's first biographer, Antonio Manetti, or the famous anecdote retold by Vasari concerning a Roman sarcophagus at Cortona. Inspired by Donatello's enthusiasm, Brunelleschi walked all the way from Florence to the small Tuscan town just to admire it. This is not the place to discuss the enormous impact that the study of the antique had on the work of Brunelleschi and Donatello. But it is essentially to the experimentalism and to the prodigious artistic imagination of Donatello that we owe the rebirth of the bronze sculpture of secular subject. Donatello's creations in bronze enjoyed an immense prestige among his contemporaries, with his musician angels from the baptismal font of Siena Cathedral, one of them today in Berlin, on the right. Donatello literally reinvented the type of deputto all'antica, known at the time as spiritello, while with the so-called Attis Amore, he ingeniously recreated an antique figure with a mysterious, complex meaning, as if it were a newly excavated sculpture. With the bronze David, made in the early 1430s, on the other hand, Donatello revived the antique genre of the male nude sculpture in the round. Significantly, in the late 14th and early 15th centuries, artists and connoisseurs expressed an increasing appreciation for the formal qualities and craftsmanship of antiquities. A good example of this outlook and approach to ancient sculpture can be found in the Commentari by Lorenzo Ghiberti, a theoretical treatise which contains the first modern autobiography of an artist. Ghiberti describes in glowing terms two antique sculptures, an Hermaphroditus and a standing Venus, that he had seen in Florence. He stressed the learning, art and masterfulness, la dottrina in Italian, l'arte and il magistero of the execution, dwelling on the supple rendering of the flesh and the refined craftsmanship of the drapery. Surviving bronzes from antiquity, like the famous Pinario, the thorn puller, which we have seen, the she-wolf, the equestrian monument of Marcus Aurelius, newly excavated sculptures, like the Capitoline bronze Hercules, unearthed in Rome during the papacy of Sixtus IV, and description of lost masterpieces by the most celebrated antique sculptures scattered around the texts of classical authors, primarily in the natural history of Pliny the Elder, fueled the imagination of artists and patrons. Collectors soon followed artists in their appreciation of the antique. Contemporary inventories certified the abundant presence among the most prestigious collections of the time, such as the ones of the Patriarch of Aquileia, Ludovico Trevisan, of Cardinal Pietro Barbo, future Pope Paul II, and of the Medici, of ancient coins, engraved gems, and cameos, and small bronzes. In Florence, the success of the small bronze of secular subjects seems to be well established in the 1470s, especially within the circle of Lorenzo il Magnifico, who, like his father Piero, was attracted by objects of precious craftsmanship. If we turn our attention to the inventory drafted in 1492 after Lorenzo's death, we find a pretty large number of small bronzes without a clear distinction between ancient and modern pieces. One of them undoubtedly relates to a figure inspired by an ancient statuette, whose real subject is the satyr Marsyas playing a double flute, in reference to the story of Marsyas' musical context with the god Apollo. The subject of the work was not recognized in the 15th century, and the posture of arms and hands, which hold no flute, as well as the expression of the face, earned the figure the name of Ignudo della Paura, literally the fearful nude, with which it is registered in Lorenzo's inventory. A recently discovered document shed further light on the origin of the small bronze. It is a record of a payment dated October 26, 1457, to Giovanni di Bartolomeo Intagliatore, the brother of the better-known sculptor Maso di Bartolomeo, for an Ignudo della Paura di bronzo, a fearful nude in bronze, probably an example of the type intended for the court of Naples. This important document provides not only the earliest terminus ante quem for this particular type of statuette, for its unusual denomination Ignudo della Paura and its presence outside of Florence, but it is also the very first document to make specific reference to a Renaissance small bronze. The more than 30 known surviving examples of the Ignudo della Paura, of which the one in Modena seems to be one of the earliest, so the one you see on the screen seems to be really one of the earliest examples of this type of statuette, testify to the extraordinary popularity of the figure in Renaissance collections, as well as the fact that it was probably commonly used in workshops as a model for young apprentices to study the human figure in motion, due to the complexity of its posture. And this is a sketchbook preserved in the Galleria dell'Accademia in Venice, where you see that a contemporary artist, a little bit later, studied one of these figures, one of these bronzes, to study the placement of space of the figure. Despite the 1492 inventory recorded a Hercules crushing Antaeus all in bronze, the discrepancy in size and the low value assigned to it, only 2 florins, make problematic the identification with the celebrated bronze by Antonio Pollaiolo today in the Bargello in Florence, which is otherwise recorded in a Medici inventory from 1587. So we know that the statuette was created in Florence at the end of the 1460s. It's believed that could have been made for Lorenzo il Magnifico. It was linked to this description in his inventory, but there is a slight problem because the size is different and the value is really low. But maybe the statuette was commissioned by Lorenzo. The statuette best exemplifies the highly original style of one of Bertoldo's most gifted contemporaries and competitors, documented as a goldsmith, sculptor, and painter closely associated to the Medici. A heavy solid cast in a piece with its triangular base, the group requires the viewer to adjust and readjust his point of view, observing the work from multiple sides to appreciate the different aspects of the physical configuration of the 2 wrestlers, which are described with incredible anatomical precision. The artist had made clever use of the lion's skin by dangling it from Hercules' waist to provide additional support, reminiscent of those required in marble sculpture. Despite some casting flaws, there is careful attention to the surface. The body's smooth skin is disrupted by muscles, tendons, veins. Hercules' lion skin and the hair of both men are intricately worked after casting. Unlike the bronze by Filarete, the Marcus Aurelius, which we have seen before, the composition appears peculiarly independent from classical models, and its archaeological appearance is achieved more by artifice and by a process of assimilation than by direct imitation of antique sources. In the same inventory, the Lorenzo il Magnifico's post-mortem inventory from 1492, 3 bronzes by Bertoldo di Giovanni are also recorded. The figure of a centaur is the only one explicitly labeled as Di Mano di Bertoldo, by the hand of Bertoldo. There are few instances in Lorenzo's inventory where there are attributions of bronzes, and the only instances are the bronzes by this bronze by Bertoldo, these only ones, and the bronzes by Donatello. But unfortunately, the center is apparently a lost work. It didn't survive to us. The second sculpture, which is recognizable as Bertoldo, is Uno Cristo Crucifixo in mezzo di due ladroni con otto figure a pie, so a crucified Christ in the middle of two thieves with eight figures on the ground, estimated 10 florins, and Una Storia di Bronzo di più cavalli e nudi, cioè una battaglia, a history in bronze with several horses and nudes, that is a battle, estimated 30 florins, which is a high value. Some of Donatello's bronzes have the same value. And these two, last two, are easily recognizable with two bronze reliefs today in the Museo del Bargello in Florence and in the exhibition. The crucifixion is probably the most compelling visual evidence we have of the relationship of Bertoldo with Donatello. The type of shallow relief, rilievo stiacciato, would have been labeled by Vasari, and the focus on movement with the wonderful floating draperies and the expression which culminates in the desperation of the Magdalene tearing off her hair at the foot of the cross, these incredible details of the women with the hair, with the sort of locks of their hair in the hands, is clearly inspired by similar works by Donatello. Vasari, in an important passage of his Life of Michelangelo, is our main source of information for Bertoldo's apprenticeship with Donatello and his high reputation as a bronze sculptor. And I quote from Vasari, "At the time the magnificent Lorenzo de' Medici kept the sculptor Bertoldo in his garden on Piazza San Marco, not just as the custodian or guardian of the many beautiful antiquities that he had collected and gathered together at great expense in that place, but more so, desiring very earnestly to create a school of excellent painters and sculptors, he wishes that they should have as their chief and guide the above named Bertoldo, who was disciple of Donatello." Bertoldo, although he was old and he was not able to work, was nevertheless a well-practiced master and in much repute, not only because he had polished with great diligence the pulpits cast by his master Donato, but also on account of many castings in bronze that he had executed himself. Of battles and certain other small works, in the execution of which there was no other to be found in Florence at that time who surpassed him. End of quotation from Vasari's passage, important passage of Vasari's Life of Michelangelo. The information provided by Vasari is entirely confirmed by contemporary evidence, especially by a famous letter of July 1479 addressed by Bertoldo to Lorenzo de' Medici, in which he declares himself disciple di Donato, pupil of Donatello. Recent archival research by Lorenz Böninger and Luca Boschetto has moreover provided scholarship with what is thus far the only documented record for a direct relationship between Donatello and Bertoldo while the former was still alive. On March 7, 1466, so a few months before Donatello died, Bertoldo, then involved in a legal dispute regarding a debt, presented himself as an artist who is skilled in bronze work, lavora di bronzo, promising the opposing party that, and I quote, "if he were to exercise his craft with Donatello and be in his workshop, and for as long as the condition might last, the master himself would be his guarantor." What is still today object of debate is the extent of Bertoldo's contribution to the bronze pulpits of San Lorenzo, and also his relationship with the role of another pupil and collaborator of Donatello, Bartolomeo Bellano, whose hand is clearly recognizable in several scenes of the pulpits.
The third work by Bertoldo, recording in Lorenzo's inventory, is the spectacular relief with the battle scene, which was originally installed above a fireplace in a small room in Lorenzo's apartment facing the Sala Grande of the Palazzo Medici, which was used as a dining room. The battle does not have a recognizable subject matter. 25 warriors, some on horseback, others on foot, are furiously fighting to no obvious end. One horseman in the middle is distinguished. One horseman in the middle is distinguished by his position and his costume, a winged helmet and a lion skin. So winged helmet would be sort of more like a Mercury, lion skin like more a Hercules. But his identification is uncertain. Four taller figures are flanking the crowded melee. Sort of go back. A nude man and a woman together, so nude woman, nude man, together with two winged figures, one, two, who reach upward to support volutes. The composition has a precise visual source. Bertoldo derived it from a Roman sarcophagus now in the Camposanto in Pisa, though when Bertoldo saw it, it was probably at the Benedictine Abbey of San Zeno. A close comparison of the sarcophagus with the bronze reliefs reveal how Bertoldo adapted it, what he understood or did not understand, and how he consciously decided to modify his source. Roman sarcophagi were often displayed in public in Rome as in Pisa and elsewhere in Italy, and they were highly regarded already during the Middle Age. An exemplary case is that of a sarcophagus with the myth of Phaedra and Hippolytus in Pisa, or also in the Camposanto, one scene of which was quoted and repurposed by Nicola Pisano for the scene of the Nativity in his pulpit in the baptistry in the end of the 13th century. So this figure is sort of clearly quoted by Nicola Pisano there. The approach of Bertoldo is very different from that of his medieval predecessor. The Pisan battle relief was probably already badly damaged when Bertoldo studied it, and the center, which probably contained the most important figure, has been entirely lost. The bronze relief is about one-fifth of the size of its prototype, but its proportions are extremely close, and Bertoldo adopted his general structure, replicating faithfully some of the figures, creatively completing the fragmentary ones, and inventing from scratch a new set of figures. This schema, which is in the catalog, is very helpful to see what sort of Bertoldo completed, what he changed, and so all the variations from the original prototype of the Roman sarcophagus. The scene on the sarcophagus is clearly identifiable as a standard representation of Romans triumphing over barbarians in battle. And the two sides are mainly characterized by markers such as clothing, beards, and weapons. Bertoldo chose to remove the clothing of the protagonist and inserted a hybrid mythological hero, perhaps Hercules, perhaps Mercury, we don't know, at the center of the skirmish, thereby completely transforming the meaning of the historia. In this way, on one side, he painstakingly reconstructed with a sort of philological process the figures missing in the original, but on the other side, he completely reinvented the scene, avoiding to impose an overarching narrative into the composition. Bertoldo's reconstruction finds a close analogy in the philological exercises of Florentine humanists, particularly those of Angelo Poliziano, who, like Bertoldo, was an intimate of the Medici household and dedicated much of his time to the correction of corrupt ancient texts. The type of composition that Bertoldo created has also several conceptual affinities with the famous print with the Battle of the Ten Nudes by Antonio Pollaiolo. The engraving shows a group of men completely naked, except for ribbons in their hair, fighting in pairs with different types of weapons. Unlike the relief by Bertoldo, Pollaiolo's image does not have a precise classical source, but very much like Bertoldo's, it is meant to evoke antique battle scenes without a specific subject matter. Like Bertoldo's relief, the engraving is a true piece of bravura in the depiction of the nude male body in different attitudes and poses. Finally, both the relief and the print are sophisticated display of invenzione, of invention, in which the artist adopted the vocabulary of ancient relief with violent battle scenes to demonstrate their artistic ingenuity, ingegno in Italian. It may be that both the print and the bronze, with their emphasis on violent brutality, relates to a new interest in primitivism in Florentine humanist circles, a fashion derived from a revived interest in Lucretius' De Rerum Natura, on the nature of things, the famous poem, which described the bestial lives of early inhabitants of the earth. As the presence of his work in Lorenzo's inventory shows, Bertoldo enjoyed a very close relationship with the Medici family, and in particular with Lorenzo il Magnifico. At the end of his life, as we know, he was living in Palazzo Medici, where a room of Bertoldo is listed in the 1492 inventory, sparsely furnished with a bed, a table, a chest, and a wardrobe. And when Bertoldo died, Lorenzo's villa And when Bertoldo died at Lorenzo's villas at Poggio a Caiano in December 1491, the chancellor of the Opera del Duomo noted the particular regret of Lorenzo, who loved him as his familiare, and the notary Benedetto Dei described him as a most worthy sculptor and an excellent maker of medals who always made fine things with Lorenzo il Magnifico, who is now very troubled, for there is no other artist in Tuscany, or perhaps even Italy, of such grand ingenuity and artistry in these things. But there are at least two surviving masterpieces by Bertoldo which were not executed for Lorenzo or any member of the Medici household, even if it's possible that they were employed by Lorenzo as diplomatic gifts, since they were apparently executed for personalities close to the Medici for political reasons. The Hercules on horseback is one of the most beautiful and original bronzes by Bertoldo, and also one of my favorites, last but not least because I know it intimately, having been the director of the Galleria Estense in Modena, where the statuette is preserved. Despite the sculpture as a privileged point of view, this one from the left side, also the right side reveals details of remarkable power, like the hand of Hercules grasping the jaws of the lion, exhibited as a trophy. Some beautiful details of the horse and the rider. Horse is very much all'antica, with a sort of curled mane, very close, very similar to the horses of San Marco in Venice, but also, and this is the detail I was mentioning, the beautiful detail of the lion, the head of the lion with the hand of Hercules opening sort of the jaws. The hero is naked, except for the lion's skin, and a thick festoon of floral bulbs, blossom, and fruits pinned on one side between the head and the rider's knee wraps around the back of the figure, fastened to the rear of the horse by a sort of a goat's head, these things here. The chasing is not always meticulous. Beautiful, here you can see this sort of not meticulous chasing, beautiful, leaving some details like a little bit rough, resulting in a vibrant surface that reflects the original modeling of the wax. Is it possible to establish who the bronze was originally intended for? Information is scant, The statuette is recognizable for the first time in an Este inventory drawn up on August 12, 1684, where it is described as a horse figure with club in hand and pedestal. The presence of the club, a rare attribute for a rider, makes certain the identification with our statuette. The Este provenance makes plausible to think that the work could be connected with Ercole I d'Este, who succeeded his brother Borso as Duke of Ferrara in 1471. Ercole loved to identify himself with the Greek hero and made it one of the themes of his self-celebration through images. At the time, in the castle of Ferrara, one could, for example, admire some tapestries known as Apparamento de Hercule, which celebrated the Greek hero as a knight. While in the novel Fatiche d'Ercole, Hercules' Labors by Pietro Andrea Bassi, dedicated to the Marquis Niccolò III d'Este in the occasion of the birth of Ercole in 1431, the figure of the Greek hero was assimilated to the perfect knight of the Arthurian novels, then a fashionable reading in the Italian courts. Over the course of the celebrations organized in Rome for the wedding of Ercole with Eleonora d'Aragona in 1473, among the exquisite pastries served during the banquet, there were four life-size figures depicting the labors of Hercules. And at the end of the banquet, a group of dancers performed a ballet which represented the fight between Hercules and the centaurs, and the episode of Hercules, Deianira, and the centaur Nessus. Even Pellegrino Prisciani, in his Historie Ferrariensis, proposed the comparison between the hero victorious on the Hydra and the Duke who drained the marshes that surrounded Ferrara. It is also possible, as it was suggested several years ago by Olga Raggio, that the insistence on the vegetal element relates to the so-called Feast of May, a popular event in Ferrara at the time. In this occasion, the Duke, alongside with other gentlemen of the court, used to offer vegetable crowns and other fresh fruit at the door of the young maidens of the city. All these elements seem to point to a celebration of prosperity and fecundity, perfectly appropriate for a festive occasion like a wedding. Is it therefore possible to believe that the statuette would have been a wedding gift, perhaps from Lorenzo himself, to the Duke of Ferrara in the event of his wedding with Eleonora d'Aragona in 1473, a date which seems to be perfectly appropriate, also considering the style of the bronze. Another key work, the Bellerophon Taming Pegasus, was admired in the 1520s by the Venetian patrician and connoisseur Marcantonio Michiel when he visited the Paduan home of its then owner, Alessandro Cappella, who possessed several antiquities and works of art. It has been persuasively suggested that the original patron or recipient of the statuette was his father, Febo, who was the Venetian ambassador in Florence from 1460 to 1480, documented in close relationship with Florentine humanist circles, in particular with the philosopher Marsilio Ficino. The sculpture is heavy and not easy to handle, being cast virtually solid, apart from the belly of the horse and its upper four legs. But it is expertly composed. The melding of Bellerophon's body with that of Pegasus provides support for the rearing horse, and even on this scale, was an issue with such a heavy cast. Actually, the figure of Bellerophon is solid cast, so it provides really support for the rearing horse. The club links the protagonist's raised arm to the back of the horse at the edge of his right wing. Similarly, the left hand of Bellerophon connects to the open mouth of the horse, and this particular placement of limbs and club equates to sprues along which the metal could circulate. The group was evidently inspired by the this beautiful detail. You can see the bronze in the exhibition, a beautiful detail of the chasing, the marvelously detailed, in this case, chasing of the wings of the horse, of the Pegasus. The group was evidently inspired by the Dioscuri, or horse tamers, on the Quirinal Hill in Rome, which famously bear the double signature of Pheidias and Praxiteles, two of the most celebrated sculptures of antiquity. Obviously, the signatures are sort of apocryphal, but they made the fame, the celebrity of these two colossal figures, which are still standing in front of the Quirinal Palace in Rome, as the works of the two of the greatest Greek sculptures of antiquity, and they were very popular in the Renaissance. Bertoldo could have seen the colossal sculptures during an undocumented visit to Rome, but he was also familiar with them through the bronze pulpits by Donatello. This is a detail of one of the bronze pulpits by Donatello in San Lorenzo in Florence. According to the legend recounted by the Greek poet Pindar, Bellerophon was able to tame Pegasus after the goddess Athena appeared to him in a dream and gave him a golden bridle for the purpose, which can be associated with the strap over the man's shoulder. The detail of the club, go back, the detail of the club is not present in Pindar and must have been an addition of the sculpture. Bellerophon became overproud and tried to ride Pegasus to the heavens. Instead, he fell to earth and was condemned to madness, while Pegasus was ultimately turned into a constellation by Zeus. The bronze can therefore be read, perhaps, as a moral warning that pride comes before a fall. Michiel, Marcantonio Michiel, the first who described this bronze in the Paduan home of Alessandro Capella in the 1520s, mentioned that the bronze group was by the hand of Bertoldo, but cast by Adriano, his disciple, indicating that he had most likely seen underneath the sculpture, where an inscription incised on the wax provides this information. Expressit me Bertoldus, conflavit Adrianus. Bertoldo design me, Adriano cast me. The inscription signals in a new humanistic fashion, very sophisticated wording, in some way, the use of words, exprimere and conflare, signals the relationship between sculpture and founder, which was not unusual in Bertoldo's and his contemporaries' artistic practice. We know, for example, that several specimens of the famous medal of the Pazzi Conspiracy, designed and modeled by Bertoldo in 1478, were cast by Andrea Guazzalotti, were cast by someone else, not Bertoldo himself. In regard to bronze sculpture, a distinction between fictor, the inventor and author of the model, and faber, responsible for the mechanical task of casting, is clearly stated by Leon Battista Alberti in a passage of his treatise on architecture. The Albertian distinction between the creative work of the mind, which is reflecting in the conception of the model, and the purely mechanical process of casting will become a commonplace in the 16th century, as exemplified by this passage from a letter of the sculptor Accursio Baldi regarding the relationship of Gian Bologna with his founder. So we are one century later, we are at the end of the 16th century, and Accursio Baldi writes, "Neither Donatello nor those della Robbia, very famous sculptors that they were less distinguished for not knowing how to fire their works without the help of furnace operators, fornaciai. Does it then detract from the praise due to Gian Bologna for his excellence, not to mention that due to others, that is not he, but a monk from San Marco who cast all of his figures and reliefs?" So here Accursio Baldi was referring to this monk from San Marco was Fra Domenico Portigiani, who cast many bronzes for Gian Bologna. In the 400, artists like Ghiberti and Pollaiolo were trained as goldsmiths. Therefore, they had an intimate knowledge of handling precious metals and of casting procedures. Sculptors like Donatello and Bertoldo, on the other hand, despite certainly familiar with the basic techniques of bronze casting, relied on specialized founders for their creations. They were inventors in the sense that they created the models and then stamped their mark after casting during the time-consuming and elaborate cold work and chasing process. The appearance of the 15th century small bronze after casting, but before the chasing was completed, is documented by another statuette by Bertoldo, also in the exhibition, beautiful statuette, the Orpheus today in the Bargello, the largest of Bertoldo's small bronzes. The Orpheus is unusually ambitious in terms of scale, being almost 18 inches tall, which is bigger than the average size of early Renaissance bronze statuettes. The bronze figure is documented already in existence in 1471, when Bertoldo handed it over to a wool merchant to whom he owed money. And we don't know who the original patron was. It is possible that the serious casting flaws, which the sculptor attempted but failed to repair, prompted Bertoldo to abandon the statuette, instead using it to repay his debt. Even if we don't know the following history of the piece until when, in 1556, it was donated as an antique bronze, classical bronze, to Duke Cosimo I de' Medici, the statuette must have been familiar to the young Michelangelo, who frequented, as we have seen, the Medician Garden of San Marco when Bertoldo was its custodian and guardian at the beginning of the 1490s. As it has been already noticed, the Cupid carved by Michelangelo, which you can see very close to the Frick, the Met, the Cupid carved by Michelangelo for the Roman banker Jacopo Galli around 1496-97, in the delicate twist of the slender torso and in the position of the head thrown back and to the left, is clearly reminiscent of the statuette of his first teacher. Thank you very much.